Well, good evening, everyone. Let's call to order our Lynnwood City Council work session for this evening, Monday, October 1st, 2018. Can you believe it? Welcome to everyone here. We'll start with item A, comments and questions on our memo items. Anybody? No? You're good? Great. Thanks. We'll move on to item B then. Tonight you'll be introduced to two candidates who are looking for an appointment to the Lynnwood Public Facilities District Board, position one. And Christy Murray is going to come to the table to take that microphone and introduce the process briefly for you, and then we'll have the candidates by last name alphabetical order come and speak with you. You'll have to bring that mic way closer to you, Christy. Thanks.
Yes, I'm filling in for David tonight to introduce our candidates for the Public Facilities District Board, position number one. Jim Marino currently holds position number one. His term expires on October 22nd, and he has opted not to be reappointed for that position. So we went through the recruitment process per resolution 2010-7. Which we've included in the packet for your reference, as also the public notices that were part of that recruitment and the resume and letters of interest from our candidates.
Point of order.
Yes.
Just for the record, it's Andy Olson who is giving up his spot. Jim Marino. He's one of the applicants. That's okay. Just for the record, just since it's on there.
Yes. Yeah. Andy Olson is in the current position. So our first candidate will be Jim Marino, and he is the owner of Acura of Lynnwood.
You have to speak louder in the microphone. Okay. But that's okay. You don't have to repeat. So, Jim, do you want to come to the table and, you know, push this microphone? I understand council has their prepared questions ready. You'll have the two candidates. Both are here this evening. So, Council President, do you want to start? Not yet. So let's, oh, you're having technical difficulties. Oh, recharge. Well, let's do this. Mr. Marino, maybe you can introduce yourself a little bit, review what's on your resume, and tell council why you're interested in this position with our PFD.
Great. My name is Jim Marino. I own Acura of Lynnwood. We've been in the city of Lynnwood since 1987. We own also two pieces of real estate in the city, one at the one the dealership sits on Highway 99 and the one on 212. We've been very involved with the city and different organizations over the years. I've been president of the Lynnwood Rotary Club, president of the Lynnwood Rotary Community Foundation, president of the Boys and Girls Club of Snohomish County, currently the president of the board for the Northwest Housing Preservation Group, which has a apartment house on Highway 99, which we rent to 55 and older. So, we've, like I said, I've been very involved in the community, and I was asked to entertain the idea of being on this board, and again, with what's going on, with what the council has before it in the next few years with the city growing and the city center, I thought it would be a great time to be involved with the public facility district.
All right. Shirley, are you the council liaison to PFD this year?
I am.
Would you like to start with the questioning then?
Yes, as soon as I could find it.
Okay.
You're aware of the
is your mic on? Is your
mic? Sorry.
That's all right. Thanks. People have busy days today.
Yeah. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here, and thank you for volunteering your time and your energy to this wonderful group of folks. I think what I want to know is part of the, just kind of going off of the recommendations of what was in the resolution for this position, can you give me an example of how you carry out your education in your community work and in your business?
How I carry out my...
Mm-hmm. How do you interact with people, basically? Especially if there's controversy.
Well, I guess I said I was in owned Acura of Lynnwood, and I think I need to clarify that as an automobile dealership. And there's controversy quite a bit in our business. I think the Attorney General for the state of Washington would tell you that between builders and car dealers, we have the most controversy out there. I think if you were to look at the Google reviews for our business, we handle ourselves very, very well. We handle controversy very, very well. The most important thing is to stay out of controversy, handle business properly, take care of people, which we do. And again, with the community, I think we've been very involved, or I've been very involved with the education process. The Lynnwood Rotary Community Foundation funded early childhood learning for the Edmonds School District. So, you know, we've done a lot to, you know, try to improve our community through that source.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Vice President Sessions.
Thank you. My question was also about how to deal with controversy, so I'm just going to switch up my question to you. So the PFD is a different kind of board and commission that we have here at the city. You're aware of that. Mm-hmm. And so this group of people really lead and manage that area of the PFDN where the convention center lies. Can you tell us any ideas of future ideas that you have for that site, or just off the top of, you know, what you do know already about it, and maybe some ideas of what you were thinking for the future of that property?
Sure. Well, I know that there were several years that between Edmonds and Lynnwood, we tried to get a convention center for both communities and performing arts centers for both communities, and those have failed. And then when the state, you know, allowed for these to occur, for the public facility departments to be districts to be formed, it was great what, both the city council forming this PFD and being able to build a convention center. So I think with the city center, and again, as a business owner, one of the first articles I read in 1987 was, where is this center of Lynnwood? And it would be nice to grow from that convention center to more civic rather than just, businesses being built in to call it, downtown Lynnwood. So whether that be a performing arts center or more education areas, I think there's a lot that can be done on that piece of ground.
Thank you.
Councilmember Hurst.
Well, Councilmember Sessions took my question.
We're just going right around.
I'll modify it just a little bit. How about this? Maybe if we go around again, I'll come back to something you talked about. But how about, what is the one thing you would change about the convention center, if anything?
It's kind of selfish. I'd make bigger doors so you can have car shows inside of it.
Nice.
That was one shortcoming that we had right off the bat. But right off the top of my head, I don't know. We've had our company Christmas parties in the center. We've had Boys and Girls Club auctions in the center. It's performed very, very well. Management, it seems to have done a good job over the years. So, and I've made some comments to a Grant in the past about some things that maybe needed to get fixed, and they were fixed immediately. So right off the top of my head, I can't think of anything.
No, I think it's a valid comment about the doors, because not only cars, but other things.
Right.
White things need to go in there, too. So, yeah.
Like I said, I was selfish for that one.
Yeah. Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. Jen, thanks for being here tonight. I appreciate you being willing to serve the community in this way and putting your hat in the ring. Just looking at your resume and looking at the, kind of the community service list there, I'm curious how, you know, when you think about the role of on the board of the PFD and you think about these other organizations, do you see any kind of nexus or ability to tie in what the PFD is as a public facilities district and what it does to some of this other community service work you've done in the past, or that any kind of community service that you might see a need for in the future?
Well, when we're working with the City of Edmonds right now. Again, I was on the board for the Boys and Girls Club many, many years ago, but I'm a trustee and I'm on their property committee. And so we have a one-year lease with every city that we're in, whether that's Alderwood over here or Edmonds, Snohomish, Monroe. So we do a lot of work with, you know, buildings and cities in that capacity, because our rents are basically $1. So there's a lot of compromise and a lot of things that we do together. And through that, we've also worked with a lot of we've worked with the Tulalips and built a facility for their youth up there. So we've through those boards, we've done a lot of work with on property.
Very good. And do you see an opportunity, just a follow-up question, do you see an opportunity to tie in the PFD with any of those activities at all? Or?
Well, there's things occurring now, with Trinity Lutheran and the community center that's being built there, that's involving Volunteers of America and Boys and Girls Club, and so there's always opportunities. Yes.
Awesome. Thank you,
Councilmember Ross.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Jim, thanks so much for being willing to serve in this capacity. They do get well fed, but now it's only once a quarter. Rest of the time it's Panera, but when the chefs cook, it's absolutely worth going to those meetings. What do you think is the most important thing you would bring to this board?
Well, I think the question's been asked by a couple of different people about, it sounds like calmness, and I think that you guys experienced that with being on the council. And watching what's happening with politics today, I think it's just a balance of being able to work with people to come out with a resolution to whatever those needs are. And I think you're asking those questions because you realize that, if we're going to be developing that property, it's going to be controversial, because there's a lot of people that want different things for the city. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Councilmember Frizzell.
So, again, thank you for being here. I appreciated you providing your resume of all the various projects and community outreach that you're involved in. I'm a bit of a volunteer nut myself, and tell me a good cause and give me a reason and I'm there. That aside, how much information and experience do you bring to the table for convention and meeting planning and hotel and hospitality management? Do you have anything on that side of the street?
No, other than having 9 siblings that I have to house once in a while when they come through town. No, I don't.
Okay, I was just curious, how long have you been in Lynnwood?
Since 1987.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Council President, final question.
Thank you, Your Honor. Jim, how would you measure the worth of the PFD to the city?
Grant told me there weren't going to be any math questions. as far as providing input to, how do you mean?
I guess to articulate more, it's more focused on your perception of what the PFD does for the city. What is the importance, I guess that could be articulated better, is what is the importance of the PFD to the city in your opinion?
Well, I think if you look at the structure of the board and how you formed, you know, back in 1999, I think it's been a very stable, you've done a great job with including council members, people from different areas that bring their, you know, insight into it. I left Anchorage, I'm originally from Anchorage, Alaska, and they just built a convention center before we left, and it was huge for, again, identifying the center of town. And after they built the convention center, they then built a performing arts center. So the public facility district can be huge for helping and direct the development of, again, the city of Lynnwood and creating a heart for the city of Lynnwood.
All right. Any final closing comments?
No.
You're good.
That's it?
All right.
All right.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
So at this time, we'd like to invite Taylor Norby to the table. Is it Norby or Norbu?
Norby.
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 Welcome. Thanks for coming. Christy, did you want to make any opening comments? You're good? All right. So same protocol, Taylor, if you wouldn't mind talking a little bit about yourself and the interest that you have in joining the PFD board.
Yes, thank you for having me tonight. It's nice to meet you all. So I was born in Seattle, raised in Lake Forest Park. So grew up around here, spent many weekends and summer nights at the mall. Been able to really see Lynnwood change dramatically in the course of my life. Bringing me specifically now to current day, I am the VP of MI Properties. It's a real estate holdings company with property in Washington, California, and Nevada. And our largest asset within Washington that I manage is in Lynnwood. So I've been spending a lot more time in the city of Lynnwood the last couple years maintaining that asset, and it's grown to be my favorite property that I manage. There's so much going on in Lynnwood. There's so much potential. And so I've been able to work with Sound Transit and the city of Lynnwood on some of the eminent domain situations as it relates to our site. Been able to work with a lot of our neighboring properties and business owners through those conversations and that work. I'm really excited for what's to come and the opportunity here, and wanted to volunteer my time and be a part of it in a larger capacity. That kind of coincided with this board position opening up, and thought this would be a great opportunity to get more involved and put my name in for the position.
Wonderful. So try to stay as consistent as you can, and we'll start again with Councilmember Sutton.
Okay, I'll be really short on this one.
That's not consistent.
You know, you'll be working with a diverse group of folks, and everyone has their opinion. So how would you handle controversy?
Yeah, I think working with diverse people of different thought is a great opportunity to always grow professionally and personally. In terms of conflict, I think communication and listening are definitely two of the key traits to resolving any issue. Ideally, always face-to-face dialogue, I think, is the best protocol. If you're able to communicate your point of view rationally and calmly, and then pair that with really actively listening to your counterpart's point of view, I think that dialogue is pivotal in giving validation and acknowledging how someone feels. And I think everyone has the right to feel how they want to. But being able to maturely have that conversation, I think that validation in itself is a key component to finding resolution in conflict. That, at least in my experience, has served me well.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Vice President Sessions.
Thank you for being here. And I didn't hear you say in your intro how you heard about this position.
My boss sent me a link saying, is this something that you might be interested in? I had voiced to my boss and to the broker we work closely with about wanting to get involved and being excited about Lynnwood and our property here specifically. And he got the email direct link about the posting, and then I looked more into it.
Good. Thank you. So my question again is, that property there, or the convention center is, mm-hmm. and it doesn't, the PFD doesn't just cover the convention center. It also is in control of the strip mall area surrounding it and that mm-hmm. parking area, all that property. What are your thoughts on the future of that property?
Yeah, I think in doing research, there's been a lot of work done around rebranding Lynnwood and kind of this marketing plan of what the city wants to stand for in terms of tourism and come here, stay here, shop here, but also being accessible to downtown. I think with that, I've also seen a lot of thoughts about creating more of a city center, a hub. I do feel currently with where Sound Transit, where the light rail will be in the convention center and the mall, all being main attractions of Lynnwood, are a bit spread apart in terms of creating a seamless experience for a Lynnwood resident or someone coming to visit. So if we could create more of a destination hub, a core to Lynnwood, and take that property and really create that center, I do think that would be a big draw to how I'm reading and interpreting the marketing plans and the city growth plans for the future.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Hurst.
Great. Thanks for being here. So my question, what is the one thing you would change? And if it's large doors, that's got to be the oddest coincidence ever. What is the one thing you would change about the convention center?
I think kind of off of what I was just saying, the location currently as it stands, it's a little bit isolated. So I do think in the short term, if there can be more of a marketing story behind how to utilize the convention center or how to pair it with company visits, different attractions in the area, and really market it as an event center. And then also, I think it's a great asset. It's a great piece of property. I'm just curious if there could be more around the story behind it to be more of a marketing pitch for people to utilize it to its full capacity.
Great.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Honor, and thank you, Taylor, for being here this evening, and thank you for also putting your name in the hat. I appreciate your comments about wanting to activate that site more. My question is very similar. How do you see the role on the PFD board tying into other boards or community service organizations or work experience that you have?
In terms of getting, I am the type of person that likes to get involved with a lot of things and bring people together. That's part of what I like in terms of volunteer work is building that network and finding the connections to bring people together. And I think that the PFD and the Convention Center had so much potential to do that and get more involved in other organizations and work together. In terms of back prior work I've done in nonprofits and volunteer work and bringing kind of multiple groups together while getting my MBA at Foster at School of Business at the UW. I was the co-chair for Challenge for Charity, which is a student-run nonprofit organization. I was in charge of planning and executing the auction, which is their largest fundraiser, all proceeds going to the Boys and Girls Club and Special Olympics. It was not a small feat. And we were able to raise over $135,000 for our core charities. But it took a village. And I think part of why we were successful was creating a plan and utilizing our network, be it the alumni network or past people that had donated or people that we knew were just big supporters of the Huskies, and bringing all that together to really create a memorable evening that was very successful, and we were able to give back a lot. So. I think those kinds of skill sets I could bring, as well as I think there's opportunity for more collaborative work like that.
Thank you so much, Taylor.
Councilmember Ross.
Yes, thank you, Taylor, for being willing to serve in this capacity. What do you think is the most important thing you would bring to this board?
I think I would bring a different point of view. I do fully believe in, to a prior question, diverse groups of people coming together really cultivates an environment for diverse thought. and I do think I could bring a different perspective. I think with the growth plan of Lynnwood, my generation is important in the longevity and sustainability of the growth of Lynnwood. We will provide a lot, and I do think I would be very happy to help and influence and bring that perspective to everything that the PFD is doing.
Councilmember Frizzell.
Hi. Thanks for volunteering to even be here tonight. I know that that can be a big step, so I appreciate you your willingness to serve. So going back to an ordinance that was paramount in 2005, the board was asking for people who are knowledgeable in convention and meeting planning, hotel management, financial planning. Do you have some skills in any of those areas?
I have a lot of skills in those areas. I started my career out at Nordstrom assisting the VP of HR. So in that capacity, it was all planning and doing all the logistics for her travel and her meeting schedule. I moved from that into project management, program management position, where I ran nine different programs simultaneously. So that was a very detail-oriented job. Then I'd say through my formal education and getting my MBA, you learn a whole slew of skill sets that relate to the list that you just had. And then again, in my current role, it's all essentially project management in terms of managing the assets. So I feel very confident that I could bring that skill set.
All right. Thank you.
And last question, President Goodwin.
Thank you. Thanks for being here again. So my question is, how would you measure the worth of the PFD to the city? And I think with the last candidate, I kind of adjusted that to what do you consider, or how would you consider the importance of the PFD to the city as compared to other entities that the city has?
I think, again, with the plans of the growth of Lynnwood, it's as important as ever. The PFD is supposed to be a catalyst for the city. The city's changing rapidly, and there's so much opportunity and growth on the horizon. And I view this board as being at the forefront of that work. And I know right now they manage the convention center and that asset, but if there are more assets down the road in terms of doing due diligence on where to put that money and how to manage those, that is my job currently through MII. So I view them as extremely important. I think it's, again, kind of to my point with the auction, it takes a village to execute on the plans that Lynnwood's facing right now. And so I think all these positions, all these people donating their time are hugely influential in that being successful.
All right. Any closing comments?
Just thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate your consideration.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Council, if I understand the resolution correctly, help me, Director Dole, if I'm off base here, but I think you have to set a date for taking a formal action of this appointment. So when do you want to make your decision on who you're going to select, what date? Yeah, Vice President Sessions?
Do we have a deadline that we need to hit?
No.
No?
I guess no.
On the memo that the term would be ending on October 18th, 2022.
Okay.
So I think that may be the deadline,
October 18th.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Councilmember Frizzell.
On the 90-day calendar, it is penciled in for next Monday.
Okay. Is that agreeable to council? Next Monday at your business meeting? Well, it's an action. Yeah. You'll take a formal vote.
It's just an action.
Right? You'll take a formal vote, which is when, when you do that at your business meeting, so that makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So next Monday, we'll let you know. Thank you so much.
Thank you both.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Christy. All right, let's move on to item C. This is the interlocal agreement for the employee health benefits. And I believe that Karen Fitzum, our procurement and records manager, and Lori Charles, our interim human resources director, will give you a brief presentation, and you'll have a moment to ask questions.
Fine. Good evening. So I wanted to give you a few minutes to bring you up to speed about our current plans for medical benefits for participating employees for the next fiscal year. So what we did, if you might recall, a year ago or so, was to come before you and talk to you about some market research the city had undertaken associated to what benefits were out in the marketplace. That was as a reaction to the fact that the current plan that many of our employees were on was not going to be continued by AWC. So we began a search and hired a broker who brought us a variety of medical plans and options to the fore. And out of that, they selected several benefits providers, medical, dental, vision, and some of the ancillary services that you're familiar with. However, the experience that the city has had has not been quite some of the positives that we anticipated coming out of that market placement. And it also turns out that we have seen something very interesting in this last year, and that is that the percentage increases that we've seen in the medical industry associated to insurance in particular has been in an unprecedented way good, in that the percentage increases across the board in the industry have actually been low. And we saw that with both our AWC providers as well as the option to stay with the current providers through our broker. So the staff here at the city has undertaken some significant analysis in this area, and I'm going to let Lori pick up some of that here next to talk to you about what we looked at and what information that we found, and we can also speak to some of the financials as well. Would you like to pick it up there, Lori?
You need to bring that closer, Lori. The mic. It's not, that one's not picking up well.
Just okay. Push it towards you. Pull it towards you. There you go.
It looks, with these glasses, it's like I'm sitting right on top of it. Okay, there we go. So we evaluated the cost, and we, like Karen mentioned, the rate increases this year are significantly lower than what we've seen in the past. One of the fees, there's a fee associated with us working with Alliant. They have a monthly per member administrative fee. So what we did is we looked at what the rate increase through AWC was going to be, which is 3.3% for Regents, which is the primary plan that people are on. And we compared that to the Premier plan that we have through Alliant, and their rate increase is 2%. However, when you add in the admin fee, the cost to stay with Premier and Alliant is higher. There's been some other considerations, so money is not the only thing that we've looked at. When right now the HR department is administering two health plans. We're administering the AWC plans for the police department. We're administering the Alliant Premier Kaiser plans for the rest of the city. And that is time intensive. Time is money, and when you start to look at the fact that you've got essentially double the work to administer both of these plans, it can be burdensome on our little department.
Yeah. Louder.
Or just talk louder. Just talk louder.
Just talk louder. Okay. I'll try. The second thing that we looked at through compared AWC and Alliant with is the wellness program. With AWC, They have a wellness program that they present to participating members every year. And they launch the programs and they give us all of the tools and everything necessary to have a successful wellness program. Under the Alliant program, what we've been doing this past year, Marielle and her team in the Park and Rec Department have been tasked with finding a wellness program. So they've actually had to go out to market, get bids, vet the programs, and determine which program they wanted to use, and launch that. And that will change year after year. You don't want to have the same wellness program every year. So, and that has turned out to be a significant amount of time and kind of burden to them as well. So when that's another factor that we weighed in determining, do we stay or do we go? We make the shift. We also looked at one of the purposes of moving to Alliant and a broker was so that we could get data about the usage of our population. When you look at the demographic of our population, it's a little scary, and it speaks to, not scary, but it's, I don't think it's what we thought it was. Boy, that was a bad statement. Sorry, let me take that one back. I don't think it was what we had thought it was going to be. 69% of our population is over 40. 39, almost 40% of our population is over 50. So when you look at that demographic and you look at medical care and needs as we get older, that is not a great demographic to have. It'd be wonderful if, you know, we had a demographic of 69% of our population was under 30, then it would be great. I'm saying this wrong. And I apologize. Thank you. So there is some concern there with the demographic and using solely our data. When we're with AWC, we are in a pool of 30,000 plus members, so that risk gets mitigated among a much greater pool than when we're standalone with our 275, 300 employees. So that was another thing that we considered before we opted to consider moving to AWC, or ask you to consider moving to AWC. There are a couple of other issues. However, Alliant has addressed some of those as far as there was a gatekeeper provision on our current Premier plan where if your healthcare provider authorized 12 visits to see a physical therapist, on visit 4, the gatekeeper would kind of intrude and say, nope, you can't get any more until you get further authorization. AWC has never had that gatekeeper provision and never will have that gatekeeper provision as long as they can not have it. Alliant and Premier have agreed to remove that gatekeeper feature for 2019, but there's been a lot of damage done with us having that in the past year. And I have talked to many staff who have run into problems because of that gatekeeper provision. So we want to make sure that we don't have that. We can afford it, which we can. So.
Yes. I wanted to kind of clear up what might seem confusing from the packet. Under the background information that we provided to you last week, we had to give you what were predicted increases, both for the Alliant package, which includes Premier as the primary medical, and for the AWC. So the numbers that you see in the packet here were those numbers that they were guesstimating or predicting at the time. However, after the deadline to put the packet together, we got the updates. So this is why you heard Lori say a few moments ago that Premier was offering a 2% increase over the previous or this current year cost, and that AWC is not at the 5 you see in the packet, but 3.3. So that's part of why I mentioned that this was just an amazingly low percentage increase I can't remember the last time I saw that low of a number. This is good news across the board, not just for the city, but for every employer that includes medical benefits is experiencing a particularly good year, and we're going to be the beneficiaries of that as well. I just wanted to make sure you understood those numbers had changed since the packet was put together.
And as a side note, we don't have a lot of staff who are on Kaiser Permanente, or the old group health, but we do have some. Through AWC, the Kaiser cost increase is 7.3%. Through Alliant, it is 15%. Alliant was not able to negotiate anything better than 15%. And the Kaiser rates this year in 2018 are about 7% more than they would be with AWC. So there is a difference there.
All right, you ready for questions, Vice President Sessions?
Thank you. So my main question is if Regents is so much better and cheaper and easier to deal with, why in the world did we change to Premier?
I didn't participate in any of that work. So I can only go by what I have been told. And the purpose, again, was so that we could, when you're with AWC and you're part of that big membership, they don't carve out the city of Lynnwood usage data. It's the data for the 30,000 plus members. Mm. So to really understand what the impact to Lynnwood is, how can we better manage based on our own demographic and our own utilization data, the only way we could try to do that is to leave the AWC family and go to Alliant, where we are a standalone and the utilization data will only reflect what our membership is how they're using the plan. So with that data, the thought was we could better negotiate better rates in following years than AWC could.
With Alliant?
So one of the key words in what you just heard Lori say is negotiate. So AWC literally says to its members, here's your increase. And that's your increase. This year it's a very acceptable increase. We're thrilled with the numbers. But that, as you probably have been aware, in this industry is the outlier, not the typical. With a broker, you do have the potential to go back and negotiate, and Alliant very much did that on our behalf, working with Premera to reduce the percentage below what it would have been just through our guaranteed second-year rates, a significant increase. Was it enough to make it attractive to stay? Obviously not. But that is not an option that you have when you're, again, like everything else, there's a pro and a con to it. Being in the bigger pool helps protect you in many ways because you're spreading out that risk. But it also means that you lose a certain measure of choice and control. So what we're saying is that we think after a year of looking at that, we haven't seen enough advantage to outweigh that desire to have that control and negotiation is not strong enough to overcome the protection we get in the larger risk pool.
So do we think that it was worth what we learned this year, worth enough to be able to negotiate our rates going back to Regents?
Regents is part of the AWC package, mm-hmm. and I don't anticipate that negotiation will be part of that program. We'll apply for membership in the group, and they will manage their relationship for the whole group directly with Regents, not...
The reason I said that is because you said that when we were part of the group, they said, this is how much you're going up. And we could be like, well, okay, because we don't know any different, so we say yes. But now we left the group so that we can learn more about our small group, and our group is actually this, this, and this. And so when we go back, and so you said we could negotiate if we knew what our needs were. you know, because right now we don't get to negotiate with them because when we're in the AWC group, because we're just in the big group. But now that we have some answers, we can go, well, you know, actually, Lynnwood's different because of this, this, and this.
I don't anticipate we would have the opportunity to negotiate for our own group. That's sort of the downside of taking our smaller group and joining that 30,000. We wouldn't have a significant amount of negotiation leverage with that larger group, that I wouldn't anticipate we'd have any room to negotiate that at all. It would be join us or don't join us.
It's got up it. To us to so say. It doesn't really matter. We can't negotiate whether we know what our situation is or not. Okay, and then my other question is it going to cost us anything, you know, like a when you leave something, what's that called?
A what? Are you joining?
Yeah, thank you. A penalty to leave Primera early, or are we leaving early? Or
so we have plenty of time within the contractual obligations. Of course, we will need to maintain our relationship with our broker and with our current insurance package through the end of this year.
Alliant.
And we'll do just that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And let them know, if they're not watching now, what our intentions are for the end of the year.
To get this.
We've had this conversation, okay. So it won't be a surprise to them.
Right. Okay. Okay. And I guess I have one more question. I'm sure that other people know, I mean, the other employees know that this is happening or going to be coming. Do they know?
They know it's being considered.
Considered.
But, of course, until the council decides one way or the other whether you support us making this move. We do have the authorization from our previous visit with you last fall to continue on our existing path, but that's not what we're recommending to you. We're recommending a return to AWC, which means that we're asking for your authorization that the mayor can apply for everyone to go back to membership in that way, because that's significantly over the threshold of what she'd sign. She needs your authorization for us to make this change.
Lori has done outreach to our labor units.
Gotcha.
And that was some positive feedback.
Thank you.
Yeah. That's all what the directors are unanimous wanting to.
That's what I wanted to hear. I'll say something after everybody else says that I'll want to come back on the list.
Okay. Councilmember Hurst.
In the background information, or actually where it talks about action, it says that the estimated value is $20 million over the course of the next 3 years. So are we in a three-year commitment then with AWC if we change?
No.
No. So, is there any way to actually get actual dollar figures rather than percentages? I'd be interested in documentation as far as the decision to make the change last year. What was the anticipated savings? But I really would like to see the actual dollars between staying with Alliant and then the change to AWC rather than percentage wise.
So there's two different ways you can look at the dollars. We've given you the estimated value because, of course, we don't know what the percentage changes will be going forward. But Lori's always also looked at it from the per premium angle, and I'll let her respond to that part.
So when we compare, when we take 2018 premiums, we increase them by the stated percentage increases that both Alliant and AWC have proposed, again, for Primera and Regents.
Mm-hmm.
There is a savings if we move back to AWC, and the savings would be somewhere around $40,000.
A year.
So, and that's the bit, that's the heavy user, that plan. But again, there will also be savings with the Kaiser plans as well.
Okay, so do we have an idea of an ultimate, you know, dollar figure for the savings? Because it really does depend on what plan folks choose, correct?
It does. Which plan people choose does drive the premiums. Historically, the $250 deductible plan this year was certainly by far the most popular. Mm-hmm. The year before, it was the zero deductible plan that went away. Yeah. So people are not hugely interested in the high deductible health plan at this point. Part of that, I think, is education. We don't really know how it works. And again, when you look at our demographic, that speaks to why the high deductible health plan may not be as attractive to our staff or to the majority of our staff. But that's, again, that's education and making sure people understand their options.
Right. I know that last year there was talk about, you know, the HR department felt that it was a burden to continue with the AWC. They seem to be running the insurance. That's how I remember it. Now we're going back to that. But it sounds like the wellness program was a real time burner. The that wellness program, was that a mandated program by Premiera? Or is that just something that the city was doing?
It was not mandated at all. And it was an add-on that Alliant provided for the city. We pay a monthly per member administrative fee. Mm-hmm. And a part of that, so the city pays Alliant that, and Alliant then pays us back a portion of that money for use towards a wellness program.
Okay.
But that's all we get.
But they didn't.
We just get money, and they say, now you guys go figure out what you want to do for a wellness program.
Yeah, okay.
Which has been challenging, whereas, again, with AWC, they send you everything for the wellness activities, and you just move forward with those.
Okay. If I remember right, when we had AWC, if a certain percentage of employees belonged to the plan, they gave a discount. Is that still in effect?
So it's not based on plan membership. It's based on wellness, and it's a wellness incentive that AWC offers. That if we get 50% of the population through certain wellness programs that they offer and they support, then the city will receive a 2% premium discount for the following year. And because we didn't participate in 2018 in that wellness program, we will not see a wellness discount in 19, but we'll certainly, if authorized to move back to AWC, we'll certainly go participate and have membership participate in a wellness program so that we can accomplish and receive that 2% discount again. We hadn't missed it for years.
Okay.
We'd always accomplish that.
Right. Okay. So when you have time, I mean, I would like just by email or whatever, some idea of the figures that we're thinking of, but it sounds like the move is going to be some sort of a savings. So, thank you.
Sure. Councilmember Ross.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Lori and Karen. We did talk about this for a long time, a number of times over a number of years. Everyone seemed to think that AWC was not the best, and we didn't have as good a service as we might get. And I think that this was really a very important exercise. The change alone was difficult for a lot of people, myself included. I did not like it. And part of it, obviously, was going from the zero deductible to all of a sudden I have to pay money. I don't like that. But I think it was really an important thing to do because we had talked about it. And, a number of times is all I can remember how many, but it seemed like everyone always thought getting away from AWC was going to be a good thing to do. And for me, it always made sense for us to be in a larger pool. It only makes sense to be able to leverage that. We don't have enough people to have a whole lot of strength in any kind of negotiation. So I'm glad we're going back. I think it's a good thing, and I'm glad that we did it because I think it was important for everybody to know that we really have it pretty good with AWC.
You're absolutely right. It has been a very good exercise. You don't know what you have until you don't have it anymore. And I think there was a lot of realization, both on the administrative side and the membership side, that AWC really does provide a great service. They're responsive. And that's not to say that Alliant hasn't. It's just to say that AWC, I think, is more in tune with cities. There's 282 cities in the state of Washington and 250-some cities are with the AWC Employee Benefit Trust. This is what they do. And I think they work hard at doing it well. Again, that is not to discount what Alliant has done. They have done a great job.
President Goodwin.
Thank you. I just to kind of tag along to what Councilman Ross just said, my understanding is that we could have, with AWC, asked them to kind of carve out what it was that we wanted as a city or our demographics and use and all that. But if we did that, we would have been stuck with what that was. So we would no longer be in that whole group of 30,000. We would be just as we are with Alliant, which I think would have put us in a worse situation than leaving, because we would have had at least another year in that. Then if we decided to leave, we'd go somewhere else and figure after a year, if that doesn't work and we try and go back to AWC, maybe we'd be able to be in that group as a whole. Maybe they would only allow us back in if we were still in that subset. So I think the same thing that Councilman Ross said, that as painful as it may have been, I really wasn't pleased with it. But finding out that information, it made sense a little more as to why we would make a move like that to get information that we wouldn't have been able to get otherwise without putting ourselves in a very precarious position where we would be stuck for quite a while. So all in all, I appreciate the information you brought back, because I think moving back to AWC would be the best thing for the employees at this moment. So thank you.
Councilmember Frizzell.
Thank you for bringing this to us. I was questioning whether or not we'd have any significant benefit changes between what we now have with Primera and what Regions would offer.
So when we moved from Regions to Primera, Alliant did a great job at negotiating with Primera, essentially an identical plan to the Regions, the AWC Regions plan. In moving back, the Regions plan has not changed, so there should not be any real significant changes between the two.
Okay. Except we still have a 250 deductible.
Yes.
The zero deductible is gone everywhere.
Gone forever.
Sure.
Yeah.
You mentioned that people weren't choosing the high deductible plan, mm-hmm, because maybe they hadn't been educated regarding it. How can we change that?
We'll work hard and during open enrollment this year to make sure that people understand the benefit of a high deductible health plan. Again, when you look at our demographic, I'll use myself as an example. At my age, the likelihood of me having a serious health condition is higher than if, 30 years ago. When I look at my insurance options and I think about that, the question that I have to ask myself is, am I okay with a 250 deductible and then having to pay some out-of-pocket until I reach the out-of-pocket maximum? Or am I okay with a much higher out-of-pocket, $1,500 out-of-pocket? And for me, I'm much more comfortable with the $250 out-of-pocket deductible and then meeting that out-of-pocket maximum. And I think that a lot of people have approached it like that. And I think it's a natural way to move from a zero deductible to let's stick with the next best, uh-huh, in their mind, which is the 250 deductible. But for some people, it may be more advantageous to move to the high deductible health plan. We just have to make sure that they really understand what all is involved, and how they can actually save money. If you have a healthy year, you've now got some money in the bank for future healthcare costs.
So there is a financial benefit to each employee, not just to the city.
On the high deductible?
Yeah.
Yes, there can be. If you don't get sick, it's great.
If you don't get sick?
You don't need it. It's great, right?
And talking about the wellness program, too, how do we better educate, get more involvement into the wellness programs?
How do we do that?
Yeah.
I think Marielle and her team have done a fabulous job of introducing and promoting our wellness activities to date. When you allow them to have more time to promote the activities versus researching, vetting, mm-hmm. pricing, mm-hmm. I think that will be very helpful to her team. I think that the programs that AWC develops and helps design are pertinent, and they're great programs. So I'm certain that Marielle and her team will have some strategies to increase wellness around the city and with our staff.
As I recall from last year, just using my memory bank, it was a $25,000 refund from Alliant to create the wellness plan. Does that sound familiar to anyone else? And so where I'm going with that is, well, if we had $25,000 to do a wellness program, then maybe that cost justify or that savings justifies the added workload to administer it.
I don't have that background, so I don't. It's not how it's working today. We actually are receiving a payment, a refund, mm-hmm. on a monthly basis from Alliant that we're putting into a separate account. Looking at Sonia to make sure you're getting on the really financial side of it.
It's okay. It's what I do.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, I have Sessions and Hurst on the list. Did you have
yes,
a
please. I do have a repeat.
Councilmember Sutton, did you have any question or comment?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, you're the only one that hasn't spoken yet.
Thank you very much. You know, I'm sitting here and I'm thinking about this, and I guess the way I'm looking at this is that some of us did basically were pretty vocal when this change took place. So what is going to be done to sway those individuals if we go back? How are you going to interact with the naysayers, of which I was one of them?
To move back.
We were there before. Then we changed,
right.
And you know, everybody changes their information, the doctors, the medical, everything. Mm-hmm. And then now if we go back, we'd have to do that. But also, what is going to guarantee that we won't be asked this question next year about this time?
I don't think there's any guarantee. I think what our goal is to make sure that we are providing the best healthcare in coverage that we can to our staff for the best cost possible. And it is the belief, and history has, I think, shown us that when we're under that AWC umbrella, we have great coverage or the best coverage that is available for a fair price. How are we going to convince people who don't want to move? Certainly it's not been broadcast citywide that we're going to make the move. But when we talk to directors, when we've talked to labor unions to give them a heads up, there has only been positive feedback of, you know, thank goodness, let's get moved back and get settled back into what we know and the service level that we know. So lots of conversation,
Thank you.
If I could add something to that, just really briefly. So one of the reasons that our timing is what it is here to be in front of you is so that we can be prompt in organizing open enrollment. So the beginning benefit date for this change, if you improve it, will be January 1st, which right now sounds like a long way away, but on the, you know, performance measurement board in the record center is how many days till Christmas. You don't want to know. But they put it up there every day anyhow. So, you know, the clock is ticking on these things. But open enrollment is a critical time to inform our employees about the various programs that they have to choose from. And there's a significant amount of that choice that's in front of them. One of the upsides of the change happening again right now, and it may be hard to somehow see how that change and then change again can have an upside, but one of those is that that provider that you were familiar with under your Regents program is probably still there, as opposed to waiting 4 or 5 or more years to switch from one group to another and have to change providers. So there's a very high likelihood that those who had to go through a difficult period of finding new providers, maybe with the Premera plan after leaving Regents, will be able to relocate to a familiar provider. So it might be a slim upside, but we need to remember that that's going to be there as an option. So open enrollment has been a very big push by our HR staff, and I don't anticipate that that'll be any different. We got terrific support from AWC for that program. They want us to get you guys enrolled on time, to be fully educated about that enrollment process, and to make your selection in plenty of time so everything can be in place January 1st. So those efforts just need to occur over the next 6 weeks or so that everybody can have all of their choices made by about the end of November, right?
Customer session?
Yes, thank you. So what I wanted to add was, now that I know that it is going to save us still a little bit of money, plus with the Kaiser savings, not having a penalty for being within the contract still, I found the process just personally pretty smooth. With my big family, even though, thank God, we're pretty healthy, we do have some unique situations when it comes to insurance. And I thought that things went pretty smooth as far as Premier, really, like you said, modeling what Regents was doing. And also, all of our providers transferred, so we didn't have to change any providers. And so I'm guessing, just because Regents and Premier are so high up there, that most providers anyway take both. So it's probably highly likely most people don't have to change providers anyway. But, of course, there still might be that. Make a very good point, the silver lining, of course, both of you. I'm in favor of it. Oh, what I was going to say, it was all smooth. However, definitely the Regents program in AWC after being in the Premier program, even though, I hate it to even complain at all because we are so blessed in general about our insurance compared to other places. Premier too, all of it. It's been great. So I hate to even complain at all about any of it. But I would say the AWC, the customer service, and the attentiveness to different questions. And also, I have gotten more complaints from providers about Premier. Like you said, that gateway thing, which I didn't really know what that meant, but that makes sense now. So in general, the providers like Regents better too. All that to say, along with, agreeing with you that our wellness program with our team does such a good job. And I think that, and just for Councilmember Frizzell, this is her first year of being an employee of the city, benefited employee of the city, that, their time is spent more on doing the programs than looking for what programs to do. So I see that the better up for that too. So I'm in favor for it. Thank you.
And I can't stress enough either the staff time in the HR department of administering two plans. Holy smokes, I don't think anybody realized what that was going to look like. And it's a lot of time.
All right, Councilmember Hurst.
Last question?
Yeah, just quickly, so I can understand this. Where we talk about with Alliant, you know, there was an expectation that costs would be reduced, data could help negotiate better rates. It's not that we didn't get the data. It's just that the data showed we were older, and so those rates weren't going to go down. Is mm-hmm. that what we're saying?
We're expensive. We have yeah. expensive data.
So we did get, we are continuing to receive data. They calculated to take some a little while at the close of every month. And in fact, the September close won't be available for some time yet. But we had a very low year, and then August we had a spike. So it's going to vary. Okay. And it takes a long time to build reasonable data. 8-9 months is right. not very useful. Yeah.
No. And I would just say, in my work experience, I worked for companies that have fewer than, you know, 20 employees. That was a big company. Every year, we would change plans. Mm-hmm. The owner would look to get a different, you know. So the city plan, when we started, I went, people don't know what they have. Mm-hmm. And even this change, you have a great plan compared to a lot of independent companies out there.
Okay.
If you do approve the change, just to give you a heads up, everybody's going to have to fill out a paper form. Just wanted to let you know that because that is, it's paper intensive for this year. The expectation is that AWC will move to an online system in 2020. So it'll get better.
mm-hmm. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Right. Council President, do you want to carry on with item D, or do you all need a break? Carry on? Okay. Let's move on to item D. This is the ILA for the Snohomish County Emergency Management Services, and Commander Steichen is joining us to give you a review of this ILA. Welcome.
I'm sure I'm plenty loud for this. Our existing ILA expires at the end of this year, so we have a new ILA before us. The new ILA is good for 3 years with an option for 3 additional years, so obviously what I'd recommend to council is ultimately for approval of all potential 6 years with the county. Frankly, they're the only game in town. But with that said, this new ILA the core aspects of it are still the same as the old ILA. They did change the formulary quite a bit to come up with what each one of the cities and what the county has to pay for to be under DEM. It really didn't change the overall costing that much at all. But the formulary is more fair, if you will. It's based on a per capita rate. It deals with growth every single year, and they use the updated estimates from the state. So I think it's a fair system. We also created, I was part of a work group of all the cities. We were working at this for 3, 4, 5 months to get this thing finally ironed out. There was a lot of debate. But they kind of created a bit of a marketplace. There's 4 services that you get for what you pay for. And then you'll see a little farther down in some of the appendices, they have services that you can pay for that are above and beyond. Usually for the smaller cities, they need help developing their CEMPs, mitigation plans, and the county will actually help them with that. But overall, the ILA, in form and in factor, serves the same as the old ILA. Slight increase, but well below what you would anticipate if you were not a standard COLA job. I think the current ILA over 3 years cost us just a little over $130,000. And this ILA, given estimates, will be under $150,000 over that same period of time. So not too bad, in my opinion.
Questions, Council? Yes, Councilor Cotton.
So thank you, Commander Steichen. Just a quick clarifier. If we go all in on the 6, does that freeze the per capita rate, or or it's formulaic and then it goes up at a step in the terms of the ILA?
You're exactly right on the latter half. It's okay. Formulary, so if the city does increase in its population and the rate changes, it would impact us as well as all the other cities. So it's a step back.
Okay.
Year over year.
Awesome. Thank you. Yep.
Other questions? Again, I'd like to thank Commander Steichen for waiting. We're past your time, but also for the good work that you're providing for us with our emergency services. So thank you. Funny. All right. Thank you. Have a good night. All right. That was nice and quick. Keep trotting forward. Yes. 15 minutes or so? Yeah, let's go. Let's move on to item E. This is Title 21, Landscaping Code Update. And I think Kirk has been in front of you before, or is this your first time? He's been here before, so he's
a while ago, but.
With our senior planner. Or no, what's your title?
Some kind of planner.
Mr. Big Guy Planner, Senior Planner Guy, Todd Hall.
So just a brief introduction, and I'll just let Kirk take it over. Just to recap, we're doing a big overhaul of our landscaping sections in the code. If you've ever taken a look at it or have ever had to use it or any of that, we've got landscaping sections scattered throughout the entire code. And so we've never really had a consolidated section that's really useful for both staff and the public. And all the cities that I've worked for, every jurisdiction has a landscaping chapter. And this was the first place that I ever really saw that didn't have one. So it's so much more user-friendly and intuitive if you have a chapter that's dedicated to landscaping, and then it's just by type and use and all of that. So Kirk will kind of go through what he's come up with over the last several months since he's visited you last. Thanks.
Yeah, I think I was here in May or so. But, yeah, I did a lot of work on what Todd said, which is taking all these scattered parts, basically the landscaping requirements were in each zone portion, so single-family residential, well, not that, but multifamily residential, commercial, whatever, all had their own sections. And taking all that and comparing them together and finding out where there was duplication or where there was special stuff, and then going through all that was a challenge, as well as looking at it from the eyes of what could be updated or improved from what exists. So the summary I have up there on the screen just says, you know, placing all of it in one section, as Todd said. It clarifies not just where landscaping is required on a site, but also when it's required. Right now, it's basically just when a property is going through a development application. Wanted to look at it from the standpoint of, well, what if you, like, replace a big chunk of your parking lot, you know, but you're not doing a whole new building, like maybe they need to update it then. Updates planning requirements to be planting requirements to be similar to other jurisdictions, which say things like plants that are work with or are regionally appropriate, you know, and drought tolerant. It adds some new sections addressing things like low impact development. There were some comments I saw Planning Commission last week, and there's some things I might work on that a little bit to try to integrate low impact development a little more, but you can, you know, I'm hopefully you looked at it a little bit and you can ask some questions at the end. Or I suppose if you want to interject, but
just curious if we had looked at the types of trees that we're having planted, because as a pedestrian, the sidewalks are just awful.
Yeah, there was a couple things I looked into and added. One was requiring for buffers for like parking lots that are along the frontage next to sidewalks, that they'll need to put in some sort of root barrier thing to protect. And it also came up that we do have a tree list. It's a tree protection guidelines. And right now, because this was a lot of work itself, I just used their categories of small, medium, large. But I think the next step is to look at that list and make sure, maybe have a separate list. One's preservation, but one's looking at the landscape strips, because you know you don't necessarily want a Douglas fir in a even a 15-foot landscape strip, because it just won't work over time. But that was something I looked at, which was how to protect public infrastructure.
PUD always come in and chopping those trees off at the top because
topping is another thing, but that sort of would be an update with I think the tree protection guidelines. So I'm keeping that. I separated that out, and I'll look at that later. So you can go to the next slide.
Here, you have it. You can go to the next slide.
Okay. So the things that I did not look at, as I just mentioned, the tree preservation and protection guidelines, and also there's some special right-of-way landscaping requirements for the city center area. There are streets like Alderwood Mall Parkway, north of the mall, 48th or 44th, or maybe 38th, north-south, areas like that, that require some special tree guidelines for the right-of-way, and I didn't want to sort of touch that yet because that's sort of more city image things and just sort of leave that for later. So basically this new code accomplishes four things. It consolidates a bunch of duplicated portions into one section. It corrects a couple things. It updates some requirements to make them more in step with what other cities are doing, and then adds a few new items like the tree protection barriers or berms, for example, allowing some little hillscape type things in buffers. So consolidation is, again, just this is a part of the table that I had in the memo, and it just basically goes through some of the things I said. It takes the buffer area standards between different zones, where you have to have a buffer between, say, commercial and single family, puts them all in one spot. Parking area standards, again, puts them all in one spot, all those things. Irrigation maintenance and bonding, that's a section that was found in many different individual zones, and I just put them all in one. So my example here is four sections, which if you would read them all, they all say the exact same thing, but they're all under four different parts of our code. So that's the reason we're doing this. We don't need that. And it's confusing, and then there can be, and there's sometimes little differences that might be scribner errors and stuff, so trying to clean that up. Corrections, there's really only one correction I found that was really sort of important, which was the neighborhood commercial zone has a 20-foot landscape buffer between the neighborhood commercial zone and any single-family residential, but the actual setback from the property line or building is only 15 feet. So, like, just make it consistent, 15-foot setback, 15-foot buffer, you know. Then some updates. These are things more related to the memo I had in May. So on the left is, if you look at the old memo, those are the things that I had as headlines in the memo. The section name in the middle is what I called it in the code, and then the actual reference is where you'll find it in the code. So tree size and spacing, allowing different sizes of trees and more spacing variety, percent of ground cover plantings, increasing that or changing it a little bit. Things like that, parking lot landscaping, changing the amount and the way we calculate interior parking lot landscaping. Currently, we do it as a percentage, so it's like 10% of the parking lot should be landscaped. That's really hard to figure out. A lot of cities, they just say 20 square feet per parking space. And then it goes up based on how many spaces you have. So if you have over 100, you're going to have more space. And I did some analysis on that. Back of the envelope stuff to make sure it wasn't hopefully too onerous. So this is another example of just, this has a little laser pointer, cool. So the red striped over here is, this is all general commercial. This is 196th Street Southwest. Here's Scriber Lake Park, and the Fred Meyer is over here. So this is just a little short. This is all city center, and then it goes west towards 99. So this is a good little place to show where there's general commercial, single-family residential, and some multifamily. So between the general commercial and the single-family, you have to have a 20-foot landscape strip. And then between the multifamily and single-family is a 10-foot landscape buffer. And I think a 10-foot one here, too, if I'm looking at that right. So this just sort of shows that if these properties would redevelop, they would have to put that there. A lot of these actually already have it there, but they have the old standards, which might be just a bunch of conifer trees at 10-foot centers, you know, stuff like that. So that's an example of where those buffers between zones go. So here's the 20-foot, based on the new code, I just sort of made a example. Assuming, let's say, you have 100-foot street frontage. It's really hard to see. It's kind of dark. But right here is a fence. You're looking down on it, so 6-foot fence. And then you've got different sized trees, more distributed. And then about, I think it's 75% ground cover. And this would be 20 feet wide. And then let's say the rest of the property is over here. I just didn't show that. And you'd have the other property up here. So one tree per 30 feet, one large tree per 30 feet, one medium tree per 22 feet, or a mix thereof. And then these other things as well. So no more than 40% of one species and a 6-foot screening fence on the property line. Then, but there's an option I added, which you could put in a 3 to 4 foot berm. So these dotted lines are the berm, basically, at about a 1 foot or 2 foot increments. And then it has to be, there's no fence, I believe, but it has to have at least 3 feet or 4 feet of shrubs. So the total height would be 6 feet, comparable to a fence. And then the trees would have to be on the side of the hill or the berm facing the other property. And then this is the 10-foot wide medium screen buffer, which would be same thing of having a large tree per 30 feet, medium tree 22 feet, or small tree every 15 feet linearly. So those are sort of examples of what they would look like, at least from a top-down view. Parking lot frontage strips, basically taking the same that we have in our code now, and that is, this is actually from our design guidelines. If you have a single aisle and double-loaded parking, you need a 10-foot strip between the sidewalk and the parking lot. So there's actually a separate right-of-way area here where you have trees. And then if you have, like, a Fred Meyer or a mall-type property with multiple lanes, then you have a 15-foot strip there. And this is the one where, because it goes along, these are usually long right-of-ways, where we'll require the root barriers. And then I'm not going to go into the details on this, but this is about where this is a property on 195th Street Southwest. It's a dental office. They've got a parking lot here and a parking lot here. Instead of looking at the areas here that would be greenery, which would be interior, which actually I don't think they even have what they're supposed to have. But instead of doing it by the total area of the parking lot, we're going to say, like, if you have 18 spots, then you have to have, you know, 10 or 20 square feet per spot. And then you just put that in here or along the edge between the building and the parking lot. And then finally, completely new items in the code are when landscape requirements are triggered. So what I put in, for now at least, was if you're expanding your building footprint by 10% or your new or resurfaced parking lot by 10%, then you have to meet the new requirements, and that's pretty common. I don't remember where I found that, but other cities like Seattle and some places do that. Defining trees clearly, we didn't have a lot of definitions in the code. So saying, for example, arborvitae is not a tree. Some people try trying to say that. Root barriers, native landscaping suggestion or requirement, and then there's a sort of created a basic sort of, not really credit, but it's if you have existing green space on the edge of your property and the trees have a certain diameter at 3 or 4 feet high, which is called diameter crest height, and you have a certain number of them, then you can save that and preserve it or enhance it to become part of your landscaping instead of just mowing it all down and putting in new landscaping. So those are some of the new items. Here's just an example of the arborvitae, what they look like. And again, I heard from the city of Kirkland arborist that they get plans, landscape plans, and they're like, oh, we've got all these, we've got 40 trees, that's what we need to do. And it's like, no, those are arborvitae, so make sure those are not called trees. And then this is an example of the root barrier, 18-inch root barrier, sort of a plastic thing that goes along a sidewalk or a path or whatever. And so after this meeting, we'll schedule a planning commission and council public hearing, and then provide the final draft for hopefully action sometime in early 2019.
Okay. Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Honor. Thank you for joining us again this evening. A question about preferential treatment given to food-producing plants or trees. Was that considered, or is this, kind of your first pass, and is that on your list of things to incorporate, thoughts?
That actually didn't come up. I didn't actually think of it in those terms. That's a good idea, although I will say the Planning Commission, one of their concerns, which is not the same thing, but it was about what types of tree species are allowed in buffers and along the frontage, mm-hmm. parking lots, concern about seed dropping and clogging, stormwater, stuff like that. And I can see, in certain places, maybe fruit trees would be good, like a buffer between properties, mm-hmm. but maybe along, like 96 there in the front of a parking lot, a bunch of, could be an issue. So
yeah,
not saying that couldn't be done, but it'd have to be
thoughtfully then. Well, I know that there are kind of dwarf species out there or, smaller so that you don't end up with a 40-foot tall apple tree that's just dropping. I could see that being a mess on 196 for sure. But I definitely want to see us maybe start to think about that. I don't know that it needs to be in this iteration of this, but I'd like to just, kind of put my, put that kind of in your thought process that something like that, blueberry bushes versus just, arborvitae or whatever those are, things like that. So
we just thought that all buffers should be Himalayan blackberry everywhere. Because we don't have enough, right?
Yeah, no. I think the city had, we tried that once. I can't remember. Yeah.
Knotweed is number two, right?
Yeah, totally.
Actually, those special street right-of-way standards, there is in there for ground cover, it says ivy, that's all it says. And so I struck that in it to make it.
Thank you.
Okay, Vice President Session.
Thank you. So to make these changes, did you compare to other nearby Northwest cities that are kind of up and growing like we are? Not.
Yeah.
Which ones?
Portland, Shoreline. I also looked at Portland. That's where I got the idea for the different size trees and different width buffers.
Mm-hmm.
I looked a little bit at Seattle when I was comparing cities around how they do the parking lot, interior landscaping, how they measure it. And they were all doing it by number of parking spaces. It's just so much easier. I also talked to the city of Kirkland arborist and one of the planners who does some of the review of landscape plans, and they gave me some ideas. And then I did reach out to the Edmonds Community College, their landscaping horticulture department. I actually didn't really hear much from them, but I'm going to try to contact them again. So.
Thank you. That was a neat idea, too, but thank you.
Councilmember Frizzell.
I have a question about root barriers and how effective are they, and have those really worked in cities, and have they been studied over a length of time? Because when I read, I get positive and negative impact as to whether or not they truly contain the roots, if the roots grow under or through. Where did you find some great research?
Mostly it was my discussions with the Kirkland arborist and that, and in considering that, that what they include in their code. I didn't do a lot of extra research, I'll admit, on their effectiveness. That might be something maybe I can look into, you know, for the next iteration. They were just emphasizing that they're not terribly expensive.
Mm-hmm.
They tend to do a pretty good job for at least medium and small size trees. So it's just a question of, and it depends really on the tree and the type of root structure it has, whether it's a fast growing root structure. You can look at a tree at the top. Sometimes they say, like, if you look at a tree and you see where the leaves go, that's where the roots go, but that's not true at all. So I think, you know, that might warrant some more research, and I can look into that. Because I think you're right, you know. My struggle was the amount of things to do with this, but also trying
right.
to get some new ideas in. So before we maybe required in all those places, maybe make sure that it's something that's going to be effective.
Yeah. Enough said. I'm replacing part of my driveway because my neighbor's tree is going way beyond where the limbs go. So
I think one thing to keep in mind is where do we want to either require or encourage root barriers. One place that we require them absolutely is city center, because we're putting all this investment, especially on 196. I mean,
mm-hmm.
we're spending millions and millions of dollars on a street upgrade. The last thing we want to have happen in 10 years is to have root intrusion. So that's something that's, without being said, that's going to happen on major boulevards. And that may be something we just encourage or require on all the major streets. But in residential collector streets or things like that where we've had some intrusion, I don't know, just example, like maybe 48th or 52nd or streets like that that are secondary roads that we may want to consider putting in there that should have a root barrier, whereas residential streets typically, in my experience, don't have root barriers unless it's kind of a newer subdivision or something like that.
And by definition of the landscape code, you're not going to have any residential
yeah.
areas because it's only the buffers between the zones.
Right.
And it's only parking lots, and you don't have parking lots.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I think it would just be a beneficial thing to give some education about, because in the long run, this particular tree has been there 50 years and wasn't a problem until 10 years ago. So.
Other questions, comments? Closing comments?
One closing comment, if there's no questions. One other thing that we've talked about, whether it's in the landscaping kind of context or sustainability, is we're trying to incorporate more discussion about low-impact development, and one of the ways is through landscaping. I will say, though, although we try as much as possible to encourage it, we have such poor soils throughout the Puget Sound area, so I'm sure you all heard that or aware of that in your own. Just get a shovel and dig down deep enough, and you'll see all the glacial till. And so having that mechanism or light or low-impact development technique is limited in the areas within our city and frankly, in all the region, because of just that case, there's just so much glacial till. So you only got about a foot, maybe, of good, nice dirt, and then after that, you need a pickaxe to really get in there. So that's the infiltration is going to be pretty poor. There are some spots, I think, down by the mall, and you know, there's a lot of peat that it just soaks in really good. But for the most part, all the hilly areas and the upper Highlands, if you will, of Lynnwood, it's just that rock. So it's tough to really go that route. But I know we have a low-impact development manual throughout Puget Sound that they advertise for us to use, and ecology really encourages it. But, again, it's just kind of that one of those challenges that everybody faces.
All right. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Take care. Well, you're way past a break. We do not have an executive session. I'd like to introduce, in my mayor's comments, Thomas Fairchild, right? He's in the back here, and he is Natalie's replacement for now, covering council meetings. So I just wanted you to welcome him, and glad you're here, Thomas. Yeah. Let's see. We did have a separation with the city. Leandra Thompson has separated, so that's our city center manager. So David Kleisch has put another recruitment ad out so that we can find someone else. So he will be on carrying the burden of the light rail sound transit work for now until we can replace that position. But it's kind of a big deal for us. No. Yeah, thank you. Well, maybe Dustin will come back. If there's anything else, yeah, working hard on preparing to bring you the budget message and your budget books next Monday. So very excited to do that. Council President, council comments.
Yes.
Your iPad's working now.
I have been asked to poll council members. And I was actually supposed to do this last meeting, and things kind of got away. But at the September 19th work session, we talked about the Youth Commission Task Force, and they requested time on the last work session in October, which is the 29th, because one of the things that they were tasked with, if you recall, was to come back in October to make a presentation. That meeting is very full, so if it is all right with the council, we'd like to move that to the November 5th work session, and then that would give you an extra week, and we could do that, or we could move it up if you wanted to. No, just kidding. We're not going to do that. But yeah, so if okay. If the November 5th works, perfect. Then we'll. All right.
All right.
I'm nodding my head.
Superb. And that's all that I have, I believe.
All right, Council, any other comments? Councilmember Ross?
I was noticing that the PDF or PFD ordinance needs some updating. It still talks about the enterprise. The price has been around for a while, right? So, and at that point, we might want to talk about the recruitment process altogether.
We're talking Star Trek?
Enterprise? Yeah. You know, should have heard when people heard I was going to work for the Enterprise. Yeah.
Just don't wear a red shirt.
Councilmember Hurst.
Yeah. Couple of things on schedule. You mentioned November 5th, so I was concerned. I know in July we talked about street parking and perhaps permitting and trying to get a policy going. And at that time, Director France had indicated, he said shortly after our break he'd be with us, and that Paul Colfoot was actually writing an ordinance. But now that's been... Is that definite that we're going to do that on November 5th? Because it seems, I'm not sure the agenda shows that.
I'd talked with him about that. I just sent him an email to see where they are. So when I hear back from him, I'm still planning to do that on the 5th.
Okay.
Depending on where they're at with the ordinance, I will update council.
Okay.
But he made it sound like, I shouldn't say he made it sound like, when he last emailed me, it sounded as if November 5th would work for them to bring that forward. So
okay, and then I had sent an email raising the question as far as the moving of the TBD board meeting from the October date, which still shows on the website, and I didn't know if do we need to do this scheduling motion. I mean, the TBD we're not in session, so how do we? How is that decided that we can move the TBD meeting?
I will need, as the TBD board president, I'll need to get back to you on that. So I apologize about being delinquent on communication. I'll need to interface with staff and understand the process, because it's a TBD board process, I think, is a little bit different than council. It's not council, it's council-matic. So I...
Yeah, I was trying to figure out where the set dates came from, and I can't find it in the ordinance someplace. It must be...
We set it in calendar every year.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks.
Anybody else? Vice President Sessions?
You were talking about the city, the parking, and I see that on the 5th that we are supposed to be talking about the city hall parking too, so I don't know if there's been confusion of which parking we're talking about. Maybe we're doing both. And it sounds like that's possibly true. But really, all I wanted to say is I hope everybody noticed the upgrades in the parking lot for our temporary viewing pleasure out there. The upgrades, we can see the parking lot better. They added lights to the trees. Did you notice? And this is a great day with the rain and the inclement weather, and I noticed right away. So I wanted Director Franz to know that I had noticed right away, and boy, they got right on it after we mentioned the new ideas, and I know he's going to talk to us more about the big picture on that, but they've been working on that, and this is temporary, of course, but still, it's ready for the inclement weather, right there.
Yeah.
Ta-da.
They cut the limbs up on the tree, too. So
yeah. Yeah, and you can see their
sight line.
I got down and was like,
oh, boy.
I like it.
All right, Councilmember Sutton.
Thank you very much, Mayor. As the representative to the Alliance for Affordable Housing, I know we try and bring the program manager, Chris Collier, to us to talk about the housing, the situation in terms of understanding what affordability means, what's substantiated, or what subsidized housing is all about. And we pay a fee, basically, for this. And I thought it would be good for him to come and sit before us, hopefully soon, and answer our questions around some of these concerns that we have. So I'm putting that on the table. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Council President?
Yeah, I want to quickly just advise the council, one of the reasons that we looked at moving the TBD meeting to November is so that it would be after our budget discussions, so that we would have information about the budget when we go to consider as a TBD board what actions we're looking to take by way of our budget, because that's the time when the TBD budget will be done. So I thought the Bill Franz and his team said, you know, just quickly advised, hey, this may be an idea that you want to look at. And so council or TBD board president Cotton and I discussed that a little bit and thought that, you know, there isn't harm in that. I know one of the concerns Councilmember Hurst has, which I think is very valuable, that if we wait until mid-November to make those changes, if we made changes, how easy would that be for directors to adjust their budgets? So, you know, those are discussions that we'll have in the next little bit. But I think it's important for us to know all of the city budget as we go into that meeting so that we can know, you know, what it is that the decisions that the TBD board will have to make. So, and that's that.
Any other council comments? Move to adjourn. Anybody?
So moved.
And all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.